Okay, thank you very much, Robert, and thank you everybody for being here this morning. So I just discovered that I can put some notes on the slides, so maybe I will try to do it if necessary. I don't know. Okay, so yesterday we finished the presentation with this result on the consistency of random forests for estimating conditional distribution functions. And I mentioned earlier that if you have the consistency of the conditional distribution function, then using more or less standard arguments, you get the consistency of the estimation of the conditional quantiles. So let us consider that we have a method that allows us to estimate the conditional quantiles with this random forest, and I will explain how we use this in order to estimate the quantile-oriented sensitivity indices. So just to recall, so the maybe the green is not a good color, I don't know. Can you see the green color?
It's readable, yes. I can see it, yes.
It's not the most important part, the green, so this is not such a problem, but I realize that this green is not good. Okay, so if I put again the definition of Sobol indices, so maybe it was somewhere, where was it? It was at the beginning, probably, somewhere like that. Okay, sorry. Okay, so I just recall how we constructed quantile-oriented indices. So we use the same formula as Sobol indices, but we replace the squared error with this distance psi alpha. So you have two way of writing them, either with this minimum quantity or either by plugging the quantile. So of course, from a theoretical point of view, these two quantities are exactly the same. But from estimation point of view, it will be different if you estimate directly this minimum or if you estimate the quantile and then plug it into the formula. Okay, so I go back to the presentation. So it was maybe there. Okay, so I rewrite these two way of writing quantile-oriented sensitivity indices. So you can write them like this: one minus this conditional, this expectation with the conditional quantile, and or one minus this ratio, which involves the minimum of the conditional expectation of the distance between y and the theta, and you take the minimum over theta. So again, from if you consider the formulas, they are exactly equal. But we will have two different strategies for the estimation. Either we will estimate the conditional quantile and then plug it into this expression in order to estimate this expectation, or we directly estimate the minimum of this quantity. And just one word about the denominator. The denominator is simply the expectation of, there is no conditional expectation in this quantity, and this is more or less standard to estimate it. And for example, you may estimate this green quantity by simply making the considering the mean over the sample, the learning sample, the training sample DN, and you put here any estimation of a quantile of y that you wish. So I will not speak a lot about the estimation of this green part, because this is not the main difficulty. The difficulty as I said before, is with this conditional quantities, two conditional quantities, either the conditional quantile or the conditionalistic expectation. Okay, so I hope that I put the correct color in the next slides. So I should have put blue for the quantile-based estimators, which means that we estimate the conditional quantile and then plug in them. Or I should have used the violet color in order to emphasize that we have used the minimum, that we estimate this minimum. Okay. So how do we do that? So we first of all, I will explain the methods based on the estimation of conditional quantiles. In order to do that, I need two training samples. So this is one weakness of quantile-based estimators, because if you remember at the beginning, I said that we are trying to explain the impact of the entries X on the quantile of Y. And usually Y is a function of X with maybe some noise or not, it depends. But the function Y is a function of X, which might be complex and which might be costly. So it might be difficult to have these two samples. So remember also that so if I go back to the framework of sensitivity analysis, maybe I should have done this before. So if I go back to, yes, sensitivity analysis, then okay, we consider that Y is a function of X. You may have some noise, but that's not the point here. Usually this function F, this function F might be costly if you think on industrial code, for example, industrial numerical code. So the usual situation is that we know the distribution of X, so which means that we may have samples as large as we want for X, but Y may be costly. So that's the global idea behind the sensitivity analysis. We try to have as less as possible call to the F function because it is usually costly. So this is the general framework of sensitivity analysis if you are in an industrial context, but also if you are in some practical real data analysis case, then you just have one sample. So the fact that we need two samples may be a problem. But okay, that's the way we are proceeding here. So I go back there. Okay, so quantile-based estimator. So in order to achieve this procedure, we need two training samples. So one is called DN star. And we will use DN star in order to compute the index. And before computing the index, we will use DN in order to estimate the conditional quantile. Okay, so of course we assume that DN star and DN are independent. And we define this quantity. So what is this quantity? We begin, here we have some estimation of the conditional quantile. So here this is an estimation of the conditional quantile at level alpha of Y, knowing that the is coordinate xi equals xi j. So we compute, we consider this estimation of the conditional quantiles, and we plug it into this mean, and so this mean allows to estimate the expectation, and okay, we consider that this will be a good approximation of the expectation of psi of y on the quantile, on the conditional quantile. Okay, so once we have an estimation of the conditional quantile, in some sense this is easy because we just make the mean in order to estimate this expectation. So there is nothing really new in that. This is just the main question is how we will estimate these conditional quantiles. Okay, so now I'm going to explain the estimation of these conditional quantiles. And so the idea behind is what we have done before on the random forest, but we will have several methods because you have many ways of using random forests. You may use them in different ways in order to estimate the quantiles. Okay. So first of all, the first method is really what we have done yesterday. So, okay, what do we do? We want to estimate the conditional quantile knowing xi. So I go back once again to the definition of the Kosa indices. So we will define one index for each xi. Okay, x is a vector. So maybe I can, I don't know, I don't think I will be able to write. So x is a vector, x1, x2, xd, and for each of the coordinates of x, we will have such an index. So this index involves the conditional quantile of y knowing xi. Okay, so in order to estimate this conditional quantile of y knowing xi, we are going to construct a random forest with this training sample, but we will use as a variable in order to construct the forest only the xi. So we will consider only this this subsample with only the xi. So when we construct the forest, remember I said that at each node in the construction of the tree, you have to choose the best random variable that gives the minimum of the variance. So in this case, we don't have to choose the best random variable because we have just one random variable, which is xi. So we explain why only with xi. And we construct the forest like this. So the idea behind is that we want to estimate the conditional quantile knowing xi. Okay. So then we estimate this the distribution, the conditional distribution function of y knowing xi. So this is exactly the same formula as yesterday. We have the weights and we have the indicator of y less than y. The only point is that we have just one input in some sense, the xi. Okay, and once we have the estimation of the conditional distribution, then we may consider we may estimate the conditional quantile in a standard way. So there are two way of doing that. You see you have r hat 1b and r hat 1o. So what's the difference between that? The difference is only if you consider here in these weights, if you calculate the weights only on the bootstrapped samples, or if you calculate them on the original sample. So you have two ways to do that. Okay, so this is a first way to estimate the quantity here in blue. Okay. And we have another way to estimate this quantity in blue is a direct estimation of quantile in a leaf. So I explain this second way to do things. So you will have R hat 2 B and R hat 2 O. So this is just a different way to estimate the conditional quantile. So you have the same forest as before. And then you want to estimate the conditional quantile when xi equals xi. So you go down the each tree and you have a look at which leaf of the tree contains xi. And then on this leaf containing xi, you take the quantile. You take the quantile in this leaf. So this gives you an estimation on each tree of the conditional quantile, and then you simply do the mean over all the trees. So k is always the number of trees, and then you just take the mean over all the trees. So the difference between the two approaches here is the impact of the forest is taken into account in the weights, because the weights are calculated over the whole forest. And in this second estimator, you estimate the conditional quantile on each tree, and then you make the mean. You take the mean. Okay, so that's two ways of estimating the Sobolin the Kozar indices. So we will try to keep try to keep in mind that the quantile based estimators are denoted R, and the one is for the weighted approach, and the two is for a direct approach on each leaf. Okay, and then we have another way to estimate Kozar indices. So I go back once again to this slide. So now we will base our estimation on this quantity, which means that we try to estimate directly the minimum of this conditional expectation, and then we will take a mean, which is standard. Okay, so minimum based estimators. So here, it is in some sense with respect to the sensitivity analysis framework, it's better because we don't need two samples. We need one sample of x and y, and we need another sample x star, but we need only to simulate the x. We don't need to compute the y's. So we said that we need 1.5 training samples. Okay, so we will estimate this quantity. So we have to estimate the conditional mean here, then the minimum, and then take the expectation. So what do we do? We consider the same weights as before. So which means that as before, we construct the random forest with this sample, with only the xi as input variable. Okay, and then once we have done that, we compute the weights, the same weights as before here, and we compute them on the second sample x star. Okay, so this quantity is tells you which are the weights of the X stars in the forest. And then we compute the psi function, which is the distance function on YJ and YP. So there is a simple remark That if we consider this dysfunction psi calculated on the sample yj, then we can prove that the minimum over theta is achieved for one of the y's. Okay, so this is a simple computation because you have something which is a piecewise constant. Okay, so then this quantity here will be an estimation of this conditional expectation here. So the conditioning is done by these weights, which in some sense the weights play the role of some kernel. So these weights are used in order to have the conditioning here. And then, so you make the sum because, okay. So this is a way to have the estimation of this expectation. And then you take the minimum over all the values that are taken by y. Okay, and so once you have done, so this part here gives you the estimation of this minimum. And then you just have to make the mean in a standard way. So once you have done that, you have two different estimators of this quantity. One, as before, one is if you consider that the weights here have been computed with the bootstrapped samples, and the other one with the original samples. Okay, so this is a way to make the estimation, and then we have a last way to do this, this one is even better than before because we need only one sample. So only one sample. So this will be really good if we have data and if we don't have a simulation code, because when you have a simulation code, you may always simulate your distribution X, and then if the function F is not too costly, then you may have as many Y's as you want. But if you don't have a simulation code and you just have data, then you have one data set and you have to do things with it. So for this last estimator, we have only one, we need only one data set. And again, we will estimate this minimum. And how do we estimate this minimum? So we consider, so you have, we begin with the estimation of this conditional expectation. So this conditional expectation is estimated here. So what does this mean? So what is L? L is the. Oh, wait, so I should have written things. Okay. So L, this L here is the leaf that contains contains the piece element of the EXIP, in fact. So you consider because you want to estimate this conditional mean, so you choose the leaf which contains XIP. So it is okay, so M will be for the leaves in the tree. So you fix one tree. So you fix one tree, which is the L's tree. Then you consider all the leaves in this tree. And then if you will consider all the elements of this leaf. And once you consider all the elements of this leaf, you compute the psi function, and you divide by the number of elements of the leaf. Okay, so you make the mean of the psi function on a leaf, and then you consider the mean of the psi function on a leaf, and then you take the minimum over over this leaf. Okay, so I'm not sure that this is completely clear. So maybe I will try to say it again. So you fix one tree, the L3, and then you fix one leaf. Okay, and on this leaf you will compute this conditional expectation. So this conditional expectation is estimated here, and then you take the mean over all the leaf. Okay, so here the p plays the rule of the theta. Okay, so here you compute this quantity will be given for that conditional expectation, because you are in a leaf. So in some sense, you consider that in a leaf you are representing one element of the sample. In some sense, this is not true because you have many elements in the leaf, but this is more or less the idea. The idea is that on one leaf you have done your construction of the tree, and the distribution of y is more or less concentrated on each leaf. So when you consider this mean on a leaf, this should be a good approximation of this conditional expectation. And then you take the minimum for all the values, all the possible values on the leaf. Okay, so this gives us two different estimators. One if you consider only the bootstrap samples in each leaf, and one if you consider all the elements of the original sample. Okay, so finally we have four estimators. We have eight estimators, because we have each time we have the bootstrapped estimator and the original estimator. So we have eight estimators, four which are quantile based estimators, and four which are minimum based estimators. Okay, and then I am going to show you some simulation in order to see which are the best, in some sense, estimators. Okay, so before I do that, I must say that we have a main problem in all this estimation is that the number of elements in the leaves is very important. So at the beginning we tried this method by fixing the number of elements in a leaf more or less, in some way, not very complicated way. We tried several values for the sample for the leaf size, but it was not convincing at all. And finally, we realized that the size of leaves is really important. So we have to find some more clever way to choose this leaf size. Okay, so we have two strategies in order to choose the leaf size. One is the cross validation that I will explain shortly now, and the other one is based on out of bag samples. Okay, so I don't know if it is large enough, so maybe you need to enlarge the picture. So what is the principle of cross validation? So we have a data set, and we will randomly cut this data set into several folds. So for example, here you have the picture here shows the training data set. And here you divide this data set into five folds. Okay, and for each group, you will take the blue one will be the test group, and the green ones will be the training groups. So you make all your estimation on this training group, and then you consider the test group in order to find to validate your procedure. So we need to have some score and so we will calculate. So we make the estimation process on these green folds, and we calculate a score on the blue fold, and we do this for several leaf size, and we will choose the leaf size that gives the better score. Okay, so that's the main idea of cross validation, at least that's the way we did it. Okay, so so I hope it is more or less clear. If it is not, I can go back later on. So what we do a little bit more precisely on this leaf issue, so we consider this quantity as a score. So why is it a score function? Because what we know is if we have here instead of Q hat, if we have the exact value of the conditional quantile, then we know that the expectation of this quantity with the exact quantile is minimum, because the conditional quantiles realize the minimum of this function psi. So we consider this quantity as a score. So we will compute, if you think to the cross validation procedure that I just explained. So we do the construction of the trees, of the forest, the estimation that I have just presented. And on this blue fold, we compute this score, and at the end we will do this for many values of leaf size, and we will keep the leaf size that gives the minimum for this score function. Okay, so that's what is written here in the first point. In the cross validation process, we take a grid of possible leaf size, and then we will keep the forest with leaf size which realize this minimal score. Okay, so this is the first way to achieve the leaf size issue. I must say that it is quite costly, because you see we have to separate the training data into folds, and we have to do this several times. So this is quite costly, and there is a way to do this with less costly, which is the principle of the out of back sample. So when you construct a tree, at each construction of the tree, you begin with taking a bootstrap sample. So of course, when you consider the bootstrap sample, you choose some of the xj, 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 yj with repetition. So of course, because you take a sample with repetition, you will not take all the possible values of xg and yg. So you have some observation that are not in the bootstrap sample, and these observations are called out of bag observation. So the idea of the out of bag procedure is that we will use these out of bag observations in order to validate our procedure. So this is more or less the same idea as in the cross validation, but in that case you don't separate your your training data, you just use the random forest procedure and you just take advantage of the fact that you are making bootstrap construction. So this means that for each tree, you don't use all the possible observation, and then these observations that are out of bag, you will use them in order to validate your procedure. Okay. So so that's the first point. So what do we do? We consider all the estimation of of the conditional quantile with the we use only the values of the sample that are in the bootstrap sample in order to estimate the the conditional quantile, and then we get an out of bag score which is written here. So this is the more or less the same value as a R hat, but here we have only the out of bag samples. Okay, and then we construct the forest with with different leaf size, and at the end we choose the size leaf which has the minimal out of bag score. Okay, so the principle for the two validation procedure is more or less the same. You need a score function, so we take this score function because this is what we are interested in, and we do our procedure on random forest and on several values of leaf size, and at the end we take the leaf size that has the minimal score, either the cross validation score or the out of bag score. Okay, so that's two ways to manage with this leaf size issue, and now just to work, because I already said it more or less, but I can say it again. The out of bag, using the out of bag sample is really much less time consuming because you do it in the procedure of the construction of the tree, of the forest. So you don't need to do additional. I mean, you need to do additional things, but this is done in the construction, in the random forest construction. This is not something which is different of the construction of the random forest. Okay, so now I can show you some simulation study. So we did this for several models, and I'm going to present a simple model because if we want to see how our methods perform, we need some models on which we know how to compute more or less exactly the quantile-oriented sensitivity indices. So we have an example, which is a simple example. So we consider here four exponential laws with different parameters. So the xi are exponential laws of parameter lambda I. And then we consider for y simply the sum. So this is a really simple model. And why did we choose this model? Simply because using computation from Étienne Marceau, we may have I said semi-closed form formula for the quasar indices. So this is semi-closed because the formulas for quasar indices in this model involve some integrals that are more or less part of gamma functions. So This is why I said it is semi-closed, because this is not exactly closed, but we have some performant procedure in order to approximate integrals that are more or less gamma part of gamma integrals. Okay, so we did a simulation study with this parameter. So lambda 1 is 1/2, lambda 2 is 1, lambda 3 is 1.5, and lambda 4 is 2. So we chose this, we chose the sample size 10 to the 4th, which is quite big if you think to sensitivity analysis. But of course, we are estimating conditional expectation or conditional quantile, and you cannot hope to have good approximation of conditional expectation with really small samples. So each time we have considered 100 trees, and so I will present some box plot with 100 repetitions. Okay, so what are the results for this in this model? So maybe here it is necessary to enlarge the picture. So on this slide, you see the quantile based methods. So for this part here on the left is so this okay. So the first line is what I called before R1. So this is R1 with the bootstrap sample. Here this is R1 with the original sample. So we call that R1. This method on the first line is quantile-based method, and the quantile, the conditional quantile are estimated with the weighted distribution function. And the second row, this is for R2. So R2, we estimate the quantiles on the leaves, and then we make the mean of all the over all the forests of these estimated quantiles. So first line is the weighted method, and second line is the leaf method. And on the left, you have the method with the bootstrap sample, and on the right with the original sample. Okay, so one remark global is that you see that the box plots are quite concentrated. So this means that we have small variation of the method. You have these violet points here. I don't know if you don't see them very well, which are the true values. And then here you have the box plot for the first variable. So the first variable was the xi with lambda 1 equals 1/2. So this means that this is the smallest parameter of the exponential law. So this means that this random variable has the largest expectation and the largest variance, because these are exponential laws. Okay, so what do we see? First of all, we see that okay, another point. On the bottom here, you have 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8. So these are the quantile levels. So this means that for 0.2, we are interested in the impact of the different variables on the quantile of level 0.2. Here, we are interested in the impact of the different random variables on the quantile of level 0.4. Here for the level 0.6 and 0.8. Okay. So what we see is that whatever the level of quantile level, this is always the first variable which has the most important impact. This is not very surprising, because we are considering only exponential laws, and we make the sum of exponential laws. So, the exponential law which has the smallest parameter would be the most influential, because it will have the most important expectation, the most important variance, and the most important quantiles also. So, This is not very surprising as a result. We mind that this is just a toy model in order to see the performance of the estimators. What we see is that for these methods, when we plug the quantile in the estimation, we have a bias. So we see that here we are systematically underestimating the quantile. For the orange, this is the same. We are underestimating the quantile, and for the last two, this is the same. We are underestimating the quantile. So for each of these four methods, we have a bias, and also maybe this is not really visible on this picture, but yes, more or less, we can see that. We have nevertheless better estimation for the original sample than for the bootstrap sample. So this is one important thing, and we were a bit surprised with that because we were thinking that using the bootstrap sample will reduce the variance, but this is not the case here. Okay, so this is for the quantile-based method. And then I have the same slide for the minimum based methods. So this is more or less the same picture. So on the first row, we have the method with the weights, and on the second row, we have the methods with the direct estimation on the leaves, and on the first column, we have the estimations with the bootstrap sample, and on the second column, we have the estimation with the original samples. And what we see in this picture with respect to the previous one is that we see that the methods are less biased, at least for the weighted method. So this weighted method is less biased. It is not the case here for the bootstrap method on leaves, but if you have a look at this last picture here on the bottom right, we see that we have little we have more or less no bias, let's say, and okay, so that's what I wanted to say about this example. So at the end, on this example at least, we could conclude that the best method maybe is this one, which is the minimum based method with with the estimation direct estimation on the leaf. The performance of these two methods, this one with the original sample and the estimation of the conditional quantile, and this one with the estimation of the minimum with the weights, and this one with the estimation of the minimum on the leaves, they are more or less they have more or less the same performance. If you use the original sample, if you use the bootstrap sample, then we can see that we have some bias, especially for this method here, where you compute the minimum on the leaves. Okay, so I have one more. Okay, so probably it will take a little time to be charged. So I have one more simulation study, which gives you the performance of the different methods with of the four methods that we have seen, but we also considered the running time. So I don't know if you can see the picture. I cannot. Okay, so maybe it will arrive. I don't know. Okay, so maybe we have to wait a little bit. I don't know why it is so long, because as far as I remember, it was not was just a table, so it should not be so long to...
A table we can see.
Ah, you can see, because
a table. Yes, a table. Alpha 0.1, alpha 0.25, alpha 0.5, etc.
So maybe this, maybe I have a problem because I cannot see it. So I will open it on my computer so that it will be easier for me. Okay. Okay, so you have the table. So what does say this table? So we consider here a different model. So this is again an exponential model, but it is even simpler than before because we just wanted to compare the methods in terms of time of computation time. So here we have considered y equals x1 minus x2, where x1 and x2 are two independent exponential law of parameter 1. So just one remark that I want to do for this model is that in that case the different indices are not for alpha smaller than 1/2, then we have that the most important variable on the variable that has the most important impact on the quantile is x2, if the level is less than 1/2. And when the level is greater than 1/2, this is x1 that has the most important impact. Because this is simply because if you consider level greater than 1/2, then of course the high values of y are due to x1 because the x2 will give only negative values. Okay, but it does not appear in the table because the table is only on root mean square error. So RMSE is for root mean squared error. So we consider the square difference between the estimation and the exact value. What is interesting also in this model is that you can compute exactly the causa indices so that we can compare our estimation method and the real value. Okay, so what you have in this table? So we have considered only the best two estimations that we have for our method, which are the methods that are minimum oriented methods. So we compute directly the minimum here using for Q1 using the weights. And for Q2, you compute the minimum on each leaf. And we have considered only the original sample because this is this method that gives the best results as we have seen before. And then we have two different estimators, which are kernel-based estimators. So this one with the tilde is one which is for which we estimate the conditional quantile with the kernel method, and then we plug it in into the estimation. And this one with the CHECH is a method where the minimum is estimated directly with the kernel method. For these two kernel methods, we also have used the cross-validation procedure in order to choose the window size. So on the slide, you have the description of the data set. So this is a data set which contains 10 variables. The variable we are interested in is what is called O3-OPS, which is the observed ozone concentration. So we want to explain the observed ozone concentration with different variables. And what are these different variables? The most important is the variable which is called MOCAGE. And MOCAGE is for atmospheric chemistry, atmospheric chemistry called at large scale model. So this is a numerical model based on fluid-based mechanics, and it predicts the ozone concentration with this fluid mechanics model. So this is one of the variables we will use in order to predict the ozone concentration. And the other variables are one which is called jour, which means day. And this variable is zero if this is a free day, and it is one if it is a working day. And then you have a variable which is called station, which tells you at which station you are. We have five different stations. Three are in the south of France, one is near Paris, and one is in Germany, if I remember well. And then you have a temperature variable. You have two variables that are related to wind. One is wind force, and the other one is wind direction. And you have a humidity ratio variable. And you have two variables that are chemistrical variable. One is for nitric oxide concentration, and the other one is the nitrogen dioxide concentration. Okay, and this data set has been studied by many people, in particular by Philippe Bess in Toulouse. And it was built in order to evaluate the bias between the fluid mechanic model and the observed ozone concentration. Okay, so we have considered this data set, and we have more than 1,000 observations. And so I present you the results. So we have computed the COSA indices for different quantile levels. So the quantile levels are here from 0.1 to 0.9. The different variables here are in colors, and we put the percentage of COSA indices in this picture. So they are ordered. So the first one is the most important, and the others are the less important. So what do we observe in this picture? We observe that until the level 0.05, the most important variable on the in order to explain the ozone concentration is MOCAGE. So in some sense, this is natural, because MOCAGE is supposed to give you a prediction of the ozone concentration. So what does this mean? This means that, okay, the MOCAGE variable gives you some information, but if you want to improve the prediction of ozone concentration, then you must add other variables in your model. So what does this picture say? It says also that until the level 0.5, the second most important variable is the temperature. And when you go on, you go to level to higher level 0.6, 0.2, 0.9, then this is the converse. Okay, well, so this is some information. The point is that if you consider other models, for example, Philippe Bess used some generalized linear models in order to study this data set, and Broto, Bashok, and Depecker used some Sobol indices in order to study this this data set, and they both conclude that the most influential variable are MOCAGE and temperature. If you consider only finally the central distribution and and what we see here with the COSA indices is that, okay, for The most important variables are mucus and temperature. But if you look at what happens for level higher than 0.5, then you have other variables that appear, especially the variable related to wind and the variable related to this chemical quantity NO, NO2, and RmH2O. And these different quantities did not appear when considering, for example, Sobol indices. So the conclusion of that is that when you consider COSA indices, you have other information than if you only consider Sobol indices or linear model, which gives you more the impact around the expectation. Okay, for example, in the models that have been proposed by Bess and Brotto and the co-authors, the wind did not appear. And here we see that the wind becomes important for higher quantile levels. Okay, so I think I will finish the presentation. So concerning only the part two of my presentation, which was on the random forest and the conditional quantile estimation, I want to emphasize that random forest methods are useful for estimating conditional quantiles and quantile-oriented sensitivity analysis, but they are costly. So this is one point that we have to consider. I would like to say that the methods that I have been presented are implemented in Python. Kevin Elidi Kozat implemented all the presented methods in Python in order to estimate the COSA indices. And we also implemented the conditional distribution estimation in Julia. And I must say that Julia is much more efficient than Python. So one thing that I would like to do during this lockdown, which will maybe be during some time, is to finalize the COSA estimation with Julia, and I think it will be much more rapid than with Python. We don't have asymptotic distribution, and we don't have confidence interval, and I think that this is a problem, because if you look at this estimation for this mucus example, I say, okay, mucus is more important until 0.5, and then this is temperature, which is more important. But maybe if we had confidence interval, we will see that these two variables are important, but which one is the most important, this is not so clear. So of course it would be very important to have considered to have confidence intervals, maybe with using bootstrap methods or bootstrap intervals, because of course when we construct random forest we have bootstrapped samples, so we should have bootstrapped confidence intervals. Also, we should compare our method with generalized random forests that have been proposed by Atleti, Tipshirani, and Wager recently. And in their methods, they propose to change the cost function in the construction of the trees. So it should be compared to what we have done. And okay, some final conclusions. I think the estimation of conditional quantiles is some important thing, and there are many work to be done in this direction, more generally on estimation of conditional distribution. And I must say that I think COSA indices are very interesting, but we have some interpretation issues that we should deal with. Especially, I didn't say it before, but if we consider the sum of all the COSA indices, this is not one. This could be less than one, this could be greater than one. So this is not so easy to interpret the causal indices, especially at different levels. And there is something that we should do, which is a causal chaplet, and I don't want to enter in the chaplet effect story, because this is, would need at least 1 hour to explain this, but I want to say that chaplet effect is based on game theory, and it allows to allocate to each variable some value between 0 and 1, and I think that causal chaplet effect would be something interesting. And so I finished. So you have all the references after that. And I would like to thank you for your attention. And I hope you can hear me and see everything. Yes.